Hello people, in this video we want to look at Leishmania. Leishmania is a protozoan, it is a protist, right? It is a protista. It comes under kingdom protista, it's a parasite, it is a hemoflagellate, that means it lives in the blood, right? So it is a hemoflagellate protozoan. What is the, you have seen the classification of flagellate protozoans already, correct? In that you have seen intestinal and oral genital protozoans, and now we are coming to hemoflagellates. That means the protozoans that live in the blood and they are flagellated. Okay, so that is what you have to pay attention here. If you don't know this, you have to look at the classification of the protozoans. Okay, first watch that video if you want. Otherwise, anyways, now moving on. Vector. So this is a vector-borne disease, leishmaniasis. So it is the vector here is sandfly. This is a sandfly. Actually, it is smaller than mosquito, they are saying. So this is called as phlebotomus, okay, phlebotomus or sandfly, okay, phlebotomus. There are a lot of species under this phlebotomus. So the phlebotomus means what? Sandfly. This is the vector. It is transmitting what? Leishmaniasis. Leishmaniasis is also called as Kala Azar, okay. The visceral leishmaniasis is called as Kala Azar. So guys, are you awake and are you able to understand? So we are talking about this leishmania, which is a protozoan. This is carried by the sandfly. Leishmania is not the sandfly. Some people are getting confused. Leishmania is not the sandfly. Okay, leishmania is this thing. This is leishmania. This is the amastigote form and this is the promastigote form. This is leishmania. This is carried inside the sandfly. Okay. Now, we'll come to the morphology, but just hold on. So basically, this is an introduction to leishmania. It causes leishmaniasis. The vector for leishmania is the sandfly. So if the sandfly bites you, and if the sandfly was infected with this leishmania, then we can get a disease called leishmaniasis. If it is visceral leishmaniasis, we are calling it as Kala Azar. Okay. So here you will also in this video learn about LD bodies. Leishmania Donovani bodies. Okay, we'll come to all that. So this was a basic introduction. Okay, now let's move on. So this leishmania, what it causes? Do you know what it causes? It causes visceral leishmaniasis. Okay, and it can cause cutaneous leishmaniasis. It causes only two things. What it causes? Visceral leishmaniasis and cutaneous leishmaniasis. Only two things. But again, what they are doing in old world, they are dividing it as visceral and cutaneous, and again in new world they are dividing it as visceral and cutaneous, because the organ, the species which are causing this exact diseases in different places is different. Okay, so but you have to focus only on visceral leishmaniasis for exam, this one. So you have to focus on visceral leishmaniasis, Kala Azar or Dum Dum fever, which is infecting the old world. Old world means they are calling like India and all that. Okay, new world means America. Okay, something like that you can remember. Though it is not that much only. Like other than India, there are a lot of other countries they are including in old world. Okay, so here this you have understood what old world and or what new world is and all that, right? So basically in India, let us say in India, the visceral leishmaniasis is caused by Leishmania Donovani. This is the most important thing for the exam. Okay, visceral leishmaniasis they will ask, and they will ask you Kala Azar, and they'll ask everything about it. So you should know about this Leishmania Donovani. In this video, we will look at only this. We will not look at the cutaneous part at all. Okay, we will look at only the visceral leishmaniasis. It is also called as Kala Azar and Dum Dum fever. Okay, because of the place, this Dum Dum is a place in Kolkata. Okay, where they first observed this Kala Azar, because it causes some dark skin. Okay. There is also a post-Kala Azar dermal leishmaniasis, PKDL. Okay, so this is caused by Leishmania Donovani. So this entire thing you should know. Visceral leishmaniasis of the old world, Kala Azar, Dum Dum fever, post-Kala Azar dermal leishmaniasis caused by Leishmania Donovani. Okay, so this is how it looks. Cutaneous leishmaniasis is caused by Leishmania tropica. This is also called as Delhi boil. So they can ask Delhi boil in the exam. If they ask Delhi boil, remember it is cutaneous leishmaniasis, again of the old world. And it is caused by Leishmania tropica. So please remember this also. Leishmania tropica, you remember. Okay. Now, this new world leishmaniasis. New world leishmaniasis is again visceral and cutaneous. Visceral, you have Leishmania chagasi. which causes visceral leishmaniasis. Guys, pay attention here. So visceral leishmaniasis is called, in the New World, is caused by Leishmania chagasi, and the cutaneous leishmaniasis in the New World is caused by Leishmania mexicana, Leishmania brazilensis, all this. Okay, so the name itself suggests to you America, South America at least here. Leishmania mexicana, Leishmania brazilensis, Leishmania chagasi, all these are of causing the New World leishmaniasis. Okay, what is causing the Old World leishmaniasis? Donovani tropica. The names are pretty typical of the place, right? Leishmania donovani, Leishmania tropica, which is the Delhi boil. This much you should remember. Okay, now let's move on, guys. So basically, the history is that in 1900, they observed this parasite in a dead soldier who died of dum-dum fever or Kala Azar. It was in dum-dum, Calcutta. Calcutta, at that time, the name was Calcutta. Leishman found this. Okay. And then Donovan also in the same year, he reported a patient from Madras. So together they joined the name and gave the name as Leishmania donovani. Okay. Geographical distribution, we have told you Old World, New World, everything. Habitat, you know, it's a hemoflagellate. Coming to the morphology, you know that there are two forms here. You have the amastigote form. Amastigote form means there is no flagella. And there's a promastigote form which has a flagella. There are just two forms. To make it easy for you, this Leishmania donovani has taken only two forms. It says enough, two forms are enough for me. But there are a lot of other forms in trypanosoma, etc., which is also a hemoflagellate. Now, coming to the amastigote form, no flagellum, this is actually found inside the human beings. Okay, this promastigote form will be in the sandfly. You have seen the photo of the sandfly already, right? That is the sandfly. Inside that, this will be there. What is this? Promastigote. Okay. Now, amastigote form means what? Amastigote form means no flagella. Now, what in all other parts? There will be a nucleus. There is a parabasal body. There is a blepharoplast. Blepharoplast is from where the flagella comes. And the flagella which is inside the body is called as axoneum. However, there is no flagella here. So, just remember axoneum. Okay. Now, coming to the promastigote, look at the promastigote now. In promastigote, again you have the nucleus, and then you have the parabasal body, then you have the blepharoplast from which the flagella arises. The flagella part which is inside this promastigote is called as axoneum, then it comes out, it is called as flagella. Here there is no undulating membrane, etc. Okay. Now, these stain with what? These stain with Leishman stain and Jimsa stain. Leishman, Leishmania. So it stains with Leishman stain, Jimsa stain. Okay. Now this parabasal body and the blepharoplast, these two together are also called as kinetoplast, it seems. The parabasal body plus blepharoplast together are called the kinetoplast. Sometimes they are saying that at this blepharoplast there's a vacuole also, but we have not described it here. Okay. So that is the morphology of Leishmania donovani. So we are done with the morphology of Leishmania donovani. Now we will move on. We have to look at the life cycle, pathogenesis and lab diagnosis of Leishmania donovani. Let's get started with the details. So guys, are you able to focus and understand that we have started off with Leishmania, which is a hemoflagellate. So we have so far looked at what? We looked at the Leishmania donovani, which causes visceral leishmaniasis. We are only concerned with Leishmania donovani. And here we have seen the history of it, we have seen the geographical distribution, we have seen the morphology, we have seen the habitat. Now we are going to go to the life cycle, pathogenesis, then we will look at the lab diagnosis of this Leishmania donovani. Okay. So moving on. So basically what you should understand here, there are two hosts. Okay, what are we looking at? We're looking at the Leishmania donovani life cycle of Leishmania donovani. Okay, so basically there are two hosts, you already know this, man and sandfly, correct? So two hosts, you already know this. Then which is the definitive host? Man, dog, other vertebrate hosts are there. Okay, other vertebrate hosts are there, man, dog, etc. Which is the vector? This is a vector borne disease, you know, the female sandfly, Phlebotomus, remember, this is the Phlebotomus species. Infective form is the promastigote, which is present in the midgut of the female sandfly. You already know that the promastigote form will be there in the sandfly, correct? And in man, there will be amastigote. Try to listen to this and assimilate what you hear, okay?
Phlebotomous sandfly, promastigote.
So these three go together. Phlebotomous sandfly, promastigote. Listen again.
Phlebotomous sandfly, promastigote.
Thank you so much. So phlebotomous sandfly, promastigote. So, let us draw a cute sandfly here. It's a female sandfly, remember. So, there is a cute female sandfly here. Something like this. It's a female sandfly. It has some things here. In the mouth, in the midgut, what will happen? It will have the promastigotes. In the midgut, it will have the promastigotes. Okay. Now, when it bites a human. Now, this is a human. It's going to bite this man. This is a female infected sandfly. Remember, it is going to bite him. So, the female can go deeper. So, when it goes deep, it is going to infect this man. So, this is a mode of transmission, the bite of the infected female sandfly. Okay. So, vertically also, it can be transmitted from mother to fetus, it seems. And even by blood transfusion and accidental inoculation in lab. So, blood transfusion can actually transmit leishmaniasis. Can you imagine? Yes, because it is a hemoflagellate. It lives in the blood. So it is possible that if from one man to another, it can go only by blood transfusion or mother to fetus. An accidental inoculation can happen in the lab, which you should take care. Now look at the life cycle hand-drawn. Here's a man. The sandfly is biting him. Assuming that the sandfly was infected and it's a female sandfly, it is going to going deep and hitting the blood, right? This can also happen to a dog or any other vertebrate hosts. Now, the man or the other vertebrate host, they are acquiring the infection by the bite of a female sandfly. Then, let's take red. Now, what is coming out of the sandfly? A promastigote is coming out, right? Now, there can be regurgitation from midgut of the sandfly, or it can be directly discharged from the proboscis of the sandfly. However, whatever happens, this promastigote finally reached us. That is what is important. Now, inside this man, what happens? This promastigote becomes amastigote, because in our blood, what you see is amastigote. Now, this amastigote will go inside the cell. Okay, it will go. Let us say this is a macrophage. This amastigote will go inside. It will multiply there. Okay, and it will get released from this cell. Okay. So, there are a lot of amastigotes in the blood. There are a lot of amastigotes in the macrophages. So, these amastigotes, now what happens? These amastigotes from the blood, what will happen? They will reach everywhere. They will reach the spleen, the liver, then they will reach the bone marrow. They can reach everywhere. Okay, they will reach the liver, the spleen, and they will reach the bone marrow. So, they will reach a lot of places. Okay. And especially they will attack the reticuloendothelial cells, because they are there in the blood, right? They are hemoflagellates. Now, once another sandfly comes and bites this infected man, let's assume the sandfly was innocent, it has no infection. Now, it is going to pick up these amastigotes from the infected human. Now, the sandfly, what it does, it takes up the amastigotes while feeding on, while taking a blood meal. Now, in the midgut, these amastigotes will become promastigotes. So, they will get flagella now. Now, they will start reproducing and there will be lot of promastigotes in the sandfly, which now the cycle continues. So, again, the sandfly, which is infected, will go and bite a very innocent man and transmit this leishmaniasis. Okay, this is the life cycle. Very briefly, okay? Guys, quickly, we'll just tell you again, listen. In the man, the promastigote becomes amastigote, okay? So, basically, the promastigote, what happens? It enters the macrophage, correct? Let us just look at this life cycle again, okay? In the man, what happens? This promastigote, it enters macrophage. Macrophage will come and first take off this promastigote inside, because macrophage is trying to protect us. But inside the macrophage, what happens? This promastigote gets converted into a amastigote. Now, amastigote, very powerful, it will go on dividing. So let us say this is the macrophage which ate this promastigote. This promastigote now converts inside this macrophage, it converts into an amastigote. Now inside this macrophage, this amastigote goes on dividing. So this macrophage, when you look at it in the microscope, you will see that there are a lot of LD bodies, that is nothing but these amastigotes. Then as and when these amastigotes go on replicating, this macrophage finally will have to rupture and release these amastigotes into circulation. From this circulation, they are going to hit so many organs like the liver, the spleen, the bone marrow, etc. So they are going to hit the reticuloendothelial system, block them. So there can be splenomegaly, hepatomegaly, etc. Now, when in the blood of this man, so many amastigotes are there, when a next sandfly, which is not infected, comes and bites this man, it picks up these amastigotes, which convert into promastigote in the sandfly. Okay. Hope this much is clear. So the life cycle of Leishmania donovani is complete. Life cycle of Leishmania donovani is complete. Now we will move on to the pathogenicity. Okay. Don't worry guys, this pathogenicity is same as life cycle, only some extra points. So if they ask pathogenicity, write life cycle. If they ask life cycle, write pathogenicity. Both go hand in hand. So basically, Kala Azar is reticuloendotheliosis. Okay. It affects the reticuloendothelial system. There is blockade of the reticuloendothelial system. We are here. Are you able to see? Now the skin becomes dry, rough, darkly pigmented, hence the name Kala Azar. Okay. The hair becomes thin and brittle, cachexia. That is a condition that causes extreme weight loss. Okay. Extreme weight loss will be there. Muscle wasting will be there. Spleen is the most affected. It is enlarged. So there's splenomegaly and the cut section will be red or chocolate. Okay. Red or chocolate in color due to dilated and engorged vascular spaces. So what are we talking about? We're talking about the spleen. We're talking about what guys? We're talking about the spleen. This spleen has become enlarged. If you cut it, you will see red color or chocolate in color because dilated and engorged vascular spaces. Moving on. Liver. Liver is also enlarged, but the functioning is not affected. There is nutmeg appearance like you have seen in CVC liver also, same thing, right? So what are we talking about now? We finished what? Liver. We finished liver, guys. Spleen and liver are over. So we finished about liver. Liver in what? Leishmania donovani, leishmaniasis. Okay. Now coming to the bone marrow, lot of parasitized macrophages will be there. You already know these macrophages will pick up all these amastigotes, promastigotes, and there will be lot of LD bodies in the macrophages. Lymph nodes are affected. There will be lymph adenopathy. But what they are saying is in old world leishmaniasis, lymph, they don't check that much. It does not affect that much probably. Lymph adenopathy or lymph, they are mostly in the new world leishmaniasis of the viscera. Visceral leishmaniasis is more lymph node is affected in that. Okay. Severe anemia will be there. So why anemia will be there? So this is something very important. Why RBCs are affected? Because RBCs are destroyed because of hypersplenism. Because of hypersplenism, RBCs are destroyed. There is hemorrhage, they are saying. There is less erythropoiesis because bone marrow is full of parasitized macrophages. There is less erythropoiesis and autoantibodies are there to RBC. So here, some antibodies, lot of antibodies are there to what? RBC. So this is what you have to remember, very important. This becomes like an autoantibody against the RBC. Autoantibodies against WBCs also can be there. So severe anemia. Why anemia is there in leishmaniasis? Because of these four reasons. What are the four reasons? Less erythropoiesis. Hemorrhage can be there because of thrombocytopenia, hypersplenism, spleen is enlarged, autoantibodies to RBC. Okay. And then leukopenia. Leukopenia means less number of WBCs. Thrombocytopenia, less platelets. Or so totally there is pancytopenia, means everything is affected, means pancytopenia is there. Okay. So thrombocytopenia, because of which hemorrhage, bleeding tendencies. Okay. Next. Most untreated patients die in about 2 years due to some intercurrent disease such as dysentery, diarrhea or tuberculosis. They die because of something else, like they get dysentery or diarrhea or tuberculosis and they die. Okay. after this kala azar, there is something called as post kala azar dermal leishmaniasis. So here there will be depigmented macules, erythematous patches, butterfly in distribution that will be erythematous patches and nodular lesions. You remember in which one you have seen these kind of erythematous patches with butterfly distribution? Kind of reminds me of SLE, systemic lupus erythematosus. But here we are talking about leishmaniasis, and that too post kala azar dermal leishmaniasis. They are saying there can be depigmentation or there can be erythematous patches. So probably alteration of all these. Okay. So these are the, this is the pathogenicity of Leishmania donovani. Okay. Is it clear, guys? So this was about how Leishmania donovani affects us. Okay. These are the LD bodies. So look at this LD bodies. Here you can see that this is a monocyte. Monocyte, you can see monocyte is also a macrophage, right? So monocyte, it has consumed all these, the mastigotes are dividing within it. So these are the LD bodies. Here in a neutrophil, they have shown LD bodies. So basically, neutrophil also is a macrophage, monocyte is also a macrophage. So in that you can see lot of amastigotes. In the blood also, independently, lot of amastigotes are wandering, right? So LD bodies, guys. So that was about it. Guys, in the next video, we will continue with leishmaniasis, okay? Visceral leishmaniasis, kala azar. Basically, we will look at the lab diagnosis, okay? Now what we will do, we will just take a recap of what we have seen so far in leishmania. Lab diagnosis will continue in the next video. So we saw that leishmania is a hemoflagellate protozoa. The vector is phlebotomus or sandfly. This is the sandfly. This is the morphology of leishmania. So we saw the classification of leishmania, old world leishmaniasis, new world, and in that visceral and cutaneous. In this leishmania donovani causes kala azar. Delhi boil is caused by leishmania tropica. Then in the new world leishmaniasis, you have leishmania chagasi. Then you have the leishmania cutaneous leishmania caused by leishmania mexicana and leishmania brazilensis complex. Brazil I-E-N-S-I-S, okay? That's the spelling. Now then we saw what habitat, you know, morphology, you know. Then we'll move on to the life cycle and pathogenesis. Two hosts are there, man and the sandfly. Vectors, the female sandfly, phlebotomus. Infective form is the promastigote form present in the midgut of the female sandfly. Mode of transmission is by the bite of infected female sandfly. It can also be transmitted from mother to fetus, blood transfusion, etc. We have shown you the life cycle. Now look at the pathogenicity. So we saw that it affects the skin. Skin will become dry, rough, darkly pigmented. Hence the name kala azar, right? Then the hair becomes thin, brittle, cachexia. Extreme weight loss will be there. Splenomegaly, hepatomegaly, but the functioning of liver is not affected. There will be, in the bone marrow is affected, parasitized macrophages. Remember, it's reticuloendothelial system. So definitely spleen, liver, bone marrow, lymph nodes, all these are affected. Lymph nodes, there will be lymphadenopathy, usually in the new world visceral leishmaniasis. Severe anemia will be there, leukopenia, thrombocytopenia. That's why it's called as pancytopenia. Everything, pancytopenia. Most untreated patients will die in 2 years because of other causes like diarrhea, dysentery, tuberculosis, etc. There's also called as a post-kala azar dermal leishmaniasis, where there's depigmented macules, erythematous patches, nodular lesion, etc. I think what we saw here was nodular lesion, right? This one. So you can see nodular lesions here. Right? So in the next video, we will continue, guys. We will look at the lab diagnosis. Okay, lab diagnosis is pretty huge. We have direct evidence and indirect evidence. So much is there. Better we look at it in the next video, right? Then what else? We have diagnosis of post-kala azar dermal lesions, right? Actually, it's post-kala azar dermal leishmaniasis, okay? We will also look at the treatment of kala azar. So there are a lot of methods here. Some pentavalent antimonial compounds are available, or amphotericin B, paromomycin, miltefosin. A lot of things are there. Prophylaxis is the prevention. So definitely hygiene, etc. matters. So we are done so far, whatever we wanted to cover, Leishmania has done. Come back for the next video for lab diagnosis of Kala Azar. Okay. Bye bye.